Thank you, Stefano, in absentia, for the kind introduction. I wanted to speak this evening. As Stefano said, there are a lot of things to talk about. I just came back from Chicago, the opening of this fantastic exhibition that Stefano was also part of, and I'd like to thank him for being involved in this exhibition with a fantastic film about Bosco Verticale. But this evening, I think it would be interesting to talk about something different. And this presentation is actually taken from this talk is taken from the unit that I'm going to be running this year at the Architectural Association School of Architecture in London, together with Pernille Orsted and Simone Nicky, in which we're looking at architecture from a rather unusual perspective, from the perspective of information and privacy. And this is something which, I mean, privacy and architecture are deeply intertwined. There's a to the point of almost being synonymous in certain situations, particularly in the case of domesticity. And yet, this is an idea that is actually much less easy to put one's finger on than one might expect. And that's the argument that I really want to make this evening about how we really also need to rethink certain aspects of our approach as architects to the domestic sphere, to the architectural envelope, in the context of a completely changed attitude towards the idea of information. And I'm going to start out by showing you the first chapter of a film that was produced by my studio in Genova, based in Genova, Space Caviar, directed by Simone Nicky, which is the inspiration for the project that captures a lot of the ideas of the project I wanted to talk to you about this evening. It should be sound.
Our homes, our own private four walls where we can walk naked. Our walled city of family secrets and shared memories, open to our closest friends, trusted networks, and verified task rabbits. Home is where we store our belongings and accumulate dust. Home is where we return to with a car or with a click. Home is our architectural expression of trust. To take the next step in a new relationship, we invite our lover home. We are proud of our homes. We see them as a concrete extension of ourselves. We keep wish lists and bookmarks on our dream dwellings, go in debt and lend money to acquire them. It is a milestone in our lives to move out of our parents' home, move in together, acquire a home. The space which we call home might change over time, but it marks moments of community. We work on our homes meticulously, restore and customize, sacrifice our weekends. We want you to see them, to admire and desire them, to Pinterest, to Tumblr them. these are our homes. No trespassing. Private property. We indulge in a contradiction of owner's pride and paranoia. Instagram posts of last night's dinner, but locked front doors. We spin a web of listening devices around our most intimate spaces, attempting to protect what is dear and hold close remotely. Networked optics installed in high-up corners. Domestic fisheye vision streaming to our smartphones. The possibility to enter any room at any time without being there. Spatial oversight. Calming security. Yes, baby Rose is still soundly asleep. We add senses to architecture, transforming our homes into agents rather than dwellings. Agents who communicate with us, for us, and about us. Agents who assist, ever-present and ubiquitous. Smart agents. Our homes. Welcome home. All we really want is a place to eat, sleep, and love.
So this film, with this, the first part of a film in three parts that constructs an imaginary dialogue between an inhabitant of a home and the home itself, imagining a future in which the home is something sentient, that something intelligent, something you can actually relate to. But actually, maybe that future is already here. Maybe it's something we're already experiencing today. And to be able to engage this as architects, I think we first need to start out by thinking about what we actually understand by home. And it's interesting to think about what the home symbolizes for us, how the security settings of one's laptop, of one's Macintosh computer, are symbolized by the symbol of a home. And in order to be able to understand this, we also need to look at the city, ask ourselves what actually we mean by the city. What is the real image of the city today? What are the forces that define it? Is it this heroic vertical landscape, urban landscape, as we imagine it? Or is it actually something much more complex, conflictual, something that is in which multiple forces overlap in public space, in which the Madrid melts into Istanbul, and Istanbul melts into Sao Paulo, and Sao Paulo melts into Tel Aviv in a single expression of dissatisfaction with the present. What are these forces that are shaping the present city, and how are they expressed in through details that we can already see out there? Why is it that someone who is being medicated by seven different people at the same time is also most occupied, primarily preoccupied by texting somebody on his mobile phone, or maybe publishing? Is this working? And who's at the other end? Who's reading that? Where is that actually going to? And what are the forces that through which it's mediated and spread out through the city? And how does that then fold back into the most private spaces, into the domestic spaces of domesticity? How does this actually affect this kind of extremely prime archetypal idea that we have of domestic space? If we think of logere and this kind of the primitive hut, this kind of archetype of domesticity, which we still as architects base all of our which is the fundamental construct upon which every idea that of domesticity is founded, how does that collide with a completely different idea of domesticity, which is based on a notion of disposability, of nomadism, in which IKEA is possibly the full spectrum of the domestic possibilities? And speaking of IKEA, it's interesting to see the extent to which this has actually become a central cultural reference for our culture today. In the year 2000, as a Belgian artist pointed out, the IKEA catalog overtook the Bible to become the most published volume in history. By over a billion copies of the IKEA catalog are printed per year. And still speaking of IKEA, maybe one of the reasons for its preeminence is that it's the only company that's able to look dispassionately at how we actually live, to analyze, to note the fact that space is actually collapsing around us. It's extraordinary that this IKEA is the only company that was able to actually understand the fact that 12% of Londoners are actually working from the bathroom before they even go to work, that the bathroom has become a workplace. To the extent that you could even speak of the end of space, a condition in which every possible function is merging, morphing, and becoming fluid and spreading out through the cities, and to the extent that spatial specificity is no longer something that we can actually consider as architects. And in a way, the home has always represented the absolute apex of spatial specificity. You have the bedroom, you have the kitchen, you have the living room. Each of these has a very specific function, much more specific than an office space. And what are the tools through which we can actually analyze this? Here in Milan in 1973, between 1973 and 1975, there was an incredibly influential and radical group of designers, including Ettore Sottas, 9999, UFO, and several others, who proposed the idea of global tools, who proposed the idea that we actually need to completely rethink design education, architectural education, in order to be able to make use of the tools that exist around us. Kind of a connection between the primitive symbol of the hammer and the advanced technological communications that were beginning to come out at that time. And of course now, just 30 or 40 years later, the complexity of those tools has become exponentially greater. We can now experiment with hybridization of instruments with 3D printers that produce not only in plastic and metal but also ceramics, in which the role of the artisan and the role of the technologist are essentially one and the same.
These, in your own home, using
or
what's
others
called
that
a
take it even further,
printer.
That really push
this
the boundaries
like
of what we can
fiction,
actually
but to
consider
some, it's
to
not
be ethical,
so far fetched.
As MIA captures in this extraordinary video. But also technologies that were to revolutionize the future and that ended up not establishing themselves, that actually didn't enter into everyday life. And so the question we're attempting to ask with this project is, what are the new global tools that we need to consider as designers, as architects? What are the instruments that will allow us to engage with a completely transformed environment, much of which is intangible, much of which we can't actually touch with our own hands? An environment in which the landscape is perceived by us in one way, but is perceived by a lot of the devices around us in a completely different way, because, as you all know, machines can now see. And they have a vision of their own, they have an aesthetic of their own, they have an understanding of space, which is probably as complex as ours, if not more complex. And a future also in which the very idea of ownership, not only the form of the things that we design, but the very kind of conceptual basis of the things that we design has been completely transformed. If we think of Bitcoin, there's something absolutely revolutionary about this concept, and it's a piece of, you should remember that it's a piece of design, it's something that was conceived by somebody, and that completely destabilizes some of the fundamental ideas that we as a society base ourselves on, the idea of a centralized system that revolves around a government that guarantees everything that we, every transaction that we conduct, or the idea of labor as being something material. This is a Bitcoin mine in China where the idea of mining, of course, of a form of labor has been completely transformed and has been actually kind of synthesized into an electromagnetic process. And of course, many of these ideas are actually not that new. Many of them were foreseen long ago. For example, Constant's New Babylon could be described as a sort of a prescient description of the world in which we live today, in which we move fluidly from space to space and from airport to airport, in which our cities are seamlessly connected with vast empty spaces in between. Just as Constant's nomad inhabited New Babylon in a form of perpetual drifting, in which 80% of space was not private, was public, was open, and in which the main activity of the citizen was play. And one could imagine these as services that completely transform our vision of the landscape, in which we rely no longer on the idea of centralized ownership or perpetual possession, but we actually check availability and proximity around us to see what's available. But actually, maybe that's something that we already do. Maybe Airbnb has already transformed the city. Maybe it's already made it into a sort of new Babylon of the neoliberal era, in which every space is available for us to access. It's said that up to 35% of San Francisco is actually available to be rented on Airbnb. And what are the rituals that have transformed? How does this actually collapse into the space of domesticity, into the space of the home? How do we, as sentient beings, relate to one another in this context? How does privacy adapt to this new reality? After all, the home, as Le Corbusier reminds us in Verso d'Architecture, is primarily a shelter against heat, cold, rain, thieves, and the inquisitive. It's a space which is attempting at every moment to be distinct from the space of the public. And in an age in which we can no longer rely on any information being kept private, many of you probably this summer witnessed the kind of theatrical playing out of the Ashley Madison drama, in which a website for extramarital affairs leaked 30 million of its database of 30 million of its subscribers onto the open web, and in which even the devices around us are possibly undertaking activities that we could never even really understand. But then, if your fridge did to you what you do to it, then maybe you'd be justified in that. And so, the landscape of domesticity is a profoundly transformed landscape. It's one in which we, possibly, far from being in the environment that we consider to be the most protected, possibly we're in the environment in which we are most closely observed. The Nest thermostat, for example, in exchange for a degree of convenience, is keeping us in a state of perpetual scrutiny, is collecting information and is relaying it back to a distant base. To the point that, and the rush for the space of domesticity, the rush to smarten the home, could be described as a new rush for oil or a new gold rush. But on the other hand, it's also very easy to forget that actually much of this data that's out there, much of this information that we are that is being collected and collated about us, is actually being provided by us ourselves. There's an extraordinary website that's called I Know Where Your Cat Lives, that actually simply takes existing information on the internet, photographs of the cats from Instagram, and maps them onto a Google map to the extent that you can actually search for cats in distant cities without ever even needing to go there. And you can click on the random cat button to be taken to a new city, a new cat, anywhere around the world, whenever your cat craving hits you. And this is having effects on what we understand as architecture. If you think of the metaphors that we use in computer science, the backdoor, the firewall, or even the Facebook wall, to the point that if you search on Google for wall and privacy, it's very difficult to find anything that's actually related to the home or to architecture, but it's primarily about Facebook itself. And of course, Facebook, to ensure his own privacy, Zuckerberg has the means to purchase all of the properties around him. So his own consciousness of the idea of privacy is extremely concrete. But ours is often limited to the possibility of actually blurring ourselves out on the internet and hiding behind some kind of digital nebulous screen. And the technologies also of surveillance, of governance, of authority beyond which no space exists. And all of this led to the question: does the home need an airplane mode? What are the boundaries between the inside and the outside? What are the barriers that can either allow or impede communication between the interior and the exterior of the house? if we actually analyze the wall in functional terms, in engineering terms, it's an extremely simple device. It's a device that stops passage, obviously, but it also stops the passage, generally stops the passage of light, or at least gives the possibility of stopping the passage of light and of sound. But those are, in fact, just wavelengths. They're a particular portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. And if you look at it on the full spectrum, that's actually an extremely minimal part. All the way to the left into the nano range, or into the range of cosmic rays and X-rays and ultraviolet and gamma, there's a whole other sphere of spectrum which is not actually engaged in any way by our homes. And this raises the question of what do we actually mean by architecture? What is the definition of the wall? What is the envelope that we are producing? How are these spaces configured within the home? How do we actually interact with our surroundings in order to perform these rituals of privacy throughout different moments of the day? What is the equivalent today of drawing the curtains in our homes? And the methodology of this is possibly, I think, for the architect today, one of the most interesting points. Do we go to the library? Do we simply read historical texts? Do we observe the lessons of our forefathers? Or do we look around us? Do we look at the abundance of data and of information that already exists? And this is an experiment that we've been kind of conducting on how people actually represent their own home and how they broadcast it into the world. What are the ways in which they describe the spaces? What are the new typologies that are emerging? The man cave is a quintessentially 21st century type of space, a kind of a refuge for the man and his devices. How do we readapt certain spaces of the home extremely kind of spontaneously into functions as the space of the home collapses around us, as we are able to capture less and less space for our domestic purposes? How do we readapt these spaces to new functions? How do we relate to the objects in there? What is symbolized by our furniture? And what are the kind of architectural metaphors that we introduce into these spaces? But then there are also other ways of looking out into the landscape of the internet for inspiration. And one of these that I would highly recommend that you explore is the YouTube's almost infinite abundance of cat cams. And what are the new the possibilities that technologies that were intended for a completely different purpose, what do they offer to us? What is the ballet of today? What can we borrow from the spaces of industry? And maybe this also has repercussions on how we actually think about the home. Maybe the home is no longer populated by furniture which we buy on the occasion of our marriage, but maybe it's something that we actually subscribe to. And in many ways, these are transformations that are already occurring. If you look at the Starwood Hotels chain, they actually now offer the possibility of renting a living room for 2 hours, or even there's a service called Airbnb that offers a bathroom for 10 minutes. And I think what is extraordinary about this this new urban landscape is the possibility of rediscovering play in this. But there are also complexities.
Providing free public Wi-Fi in India is no monkey business, and authorities are facing that reality in the holy city of Varanasi. Varanasi was the first of about 2,500 locations to be provided with free Wi-Fi in February 2015. But within 2 months, authorities are now facing a formidable challenge in the form of monkeys. Varanasi is home to macaque monkeys, which live in temples and are fed by devotees. But they're now also feasting on fiber optic cables. Cables strung along the banks of the river Ganges had to be replaced less than 2 months after being installed after they were chewed by the monkeys. Authorities are now looking for a more permanent solution. They can't move the temples. The city is already built up and crowded, which means that they cannot lay underground cables. And trapping the monkeys is not an option either, since it seems to outrage temple goers. Wonder if Modi ever thought that monkeys would come in the way of his grand IT plans. From Newspace Social Center Bureau in Hyderabad, Anant Manohar.
So this is an extraordinary portrait of the smart city of the 21st century. It's not the perfect new-built city on an artificially reclaimed island of land in South Korea. It's actually the historically layered city of the ancient world, in which complexities of technological complexities clash with tradition, with religion, with density, with disease, all of these things layering up and producing a kind of a hybrid space in which we can carve out a new form of New Babylon, a new kind of understanding of public space. And I wanted to end on a note, just showing a few images of a project that attempted to engage with this kind of revised idea of domesticity that was actually shown here in Milan at the Salon del Mobile last year, and it's called the Ram House. And it's a space which kind of questions every possible received notion of domesticity that we operate on. In other words, completely questioning the idea of the wall as a solid surface, something that is impenetrable, that can't actually be seen through, but which actually possibly responds to a completely different set of parameters, to radio waves of different lengths, of different kinds of signal-based communications. And introduces a kind of a non-permanence. It's actually possible to mount it and demount it in 24 hours and to move it around and to adapt it to a very broad set of different conditions. And that establishes a completely different relationship between the interior and the exterior. It has, in the place of traditional curtains that a home might have, it has a set of panels on the side, which are actually radar absorbent material, which is where it takes its name from, and which can actually modulate, allow one to one's smart furniture, one's smart appliances to communicate or not communicate according to the condition that one's in. In other words, to give it an airplane mode of sorts. And this is a kind of an ongoing experiment in thinking about new rituals of privacy in the age of the smart home. The point that we're trying to make is not to necessarily resist the infiltration of technology into the home, but to establish a relationship with it in which it's not a default presence, in which it's not something that's dictating on its own terms the way in which domesticity will work, but in which we are actually active participants and in which we actually have a choice. So these are... Thank you.